This under $200 3D printer has some surprising features while missing some that have been showing up in other low-cost machines. So we'll take a look at it and see how it prints right after this. I'm Brian, and you are watching BV3D. Hello, 3D printing friends, and welcome back. Today, we've got the Creality Ender-3 V3 SE, and I'd like to thank my friends at Pergear for sending this over free of charge so we could all get a look at it. We'll talk about the specs and features and take a look at some prints, then I'll let you know what I like about it, what I don't, and where it could use some improvement. So let's get right into the printer's specs and features. The printer has an injection molded plastic main body and aluminum extrusions for the X and Z axes. There's metal reinforcement inside the plastic body between the gantry mounting points. The Z extrusions have a crazy profile to them, but the X extrusion is a standard 20x20mm one. Both the X and Z axes ride on V-slot wheels while the Y axis rides along a pair of steel rods using linear bearings. The Y motor is embedded in the main body at the front. The X motor is in a new location behind the tool head, which makes it more compact, and the Z motor is in the usual place behind one of the Z extrusions. There are two Z-axis lead screws to support both sides of the X-axis, and they're connected by a toothed belt to keep them in sync. So the printer gets the benefit of dual lead screws without the added cost of dual Z motors. Its build volume is the 220x220x250mm build volume we typically expect from an Ender-3. The tool head has a direct drive extruder, which takes 1.75mm filament and passes it through a 0.4mm brass nozzle that can get up to 260 degrees Celsius. There's also a CR touch probe for mesh bed leveling. The bed has a PC build surface on a magnetic spring steel sheet, and it can reach 100 degrees Celsius. It also has a strain gauge in the front left corner, so the printer can automatically set its Z offset. The easiest explanation of Z offset, that's how far above the bed the nozzle is when the bed probe senses the bed. The printer is able to determine this value automatically by positioning the nozzle over that strain gauge and then slowly lowering it until the nozzle itself touches the bed, triggering the strain gauge. There are no leveling knobs on this printer's bed. A quick run through in the leveling menu will probe the bed and set the Z offset for you. After that, you can fine-tune the Z offset during the start of a print. There are also no knobs for tensioning the X and Y axis belts, but the mechanism is there. Instead of turning a knob, use one of the included hex keys to turn the tensioning screw. It's got a 32-bit mainboard with silent stepper drivers, and like most printers equipped this way, the loudest thing on this machine is the fans. It's got a 3.2-inch color screen with a control knob, and the screen is really nice. Unlike previous Ender-3 color screens with a knob, this one is readable at nearly any angle, and the colors don't fade or shift or wash out. It has a full-size SD card slot and a USB-C port. And Creality has been slowly adding features to the firmware. The printer has built-in PID auto-tuning for both the nozzle and the bed to help keep them locked in at the correct temperatures. Plus, it will let you edit the bed mesh values if you need to fine-tune them a little bit. And it comes with a quick start guide, tools, screws, SD card, USB card reader, etc. The SD card includes a PDF version of the manual, as well as an easy-to-follow assembly video to get you up and running quickly. Well, now let's take a look at some things I printed. This is the pre-sliced model that comes on the SD card with the printer. It took about an hour and 25 minutes to print, and it came out really good. I don't see any issues with it at all. I printed this 400% scale Cali-Cat when I was testing some settings, and apparently I had something set in a way the printer didn't like. There are a couple of places where it under-extruded, like here on the layer along the tops of the whiskers. There are also some regularly spaced issues here along the 45-degree angle of the tail and the left front corner of the cat's neck. There's some slight wispy stringing, but nothing obnoxious. Overall, I would say this one came out mostly okay. I printed a couple of McGybeer's CaliDragon models. These took about 40 minutes each and came out pretty much perfect. Great surface finish and just a slight amount of wispy stringing. Even the overhangs on the backs of the antlers and under the chin came out great. I don't think I could ask for a better CaliDragon. I printed this 3D Benchy in 53 minutes and it came out okay. It's not perfect, there's some banding on the lower hull, and a few extrusion issues here and there. So, even though it's not a perfect print, it's also not horrible. I printed Luby 3D's Aria the Dragon too. She came out pretty good. Some slight stringing like on a few other models, but nothing major, and her wings came out great. I printed a couple of articulated axolotls because my kid likes these. Each one took about an hour and 20 minutes. All the little articulated segments worked like they should, and I'm happy with how they turned out. After this video, I'll give these to my kiddo because she likes giving these to her friends. Last, I've got the rocket plane model. This one prints as a vase mode print, also known as spiralized outer contour. I scaled this up so it's as tall as the printer can print. It came out absolutely gorgeous, and I love the shine from this Polymaker Silk PLA. So pretty. Hey, if you're enjoying this video, clicking that subscribe button would really mean a lot to me. That lets me know that I'm making content you enjoy and you want to see more of it. Thanks! So, now that we've looked at a few prints, what are the good and bad points on the printer? Well, let's start with the good. I like that it has a direct drive extruder. Most printers in this price range don't have bed probes, but this one does, and I'm pretty impressed that it also has a strain gauge in the front corner of the bed, so the printer can automatically set its Z offset. And the automatic mesh bed leveling and automatic Z offset have worked well. I did adjust the Z offset value to add a little more squish to the first layer, but the mesh leveling data for the bed has resulted in consistently good first layers. And because there aren't bed adjustment knobs to mess with and change the angle of the bed, the printer doesn't have to reprobe the bed before every print. I like the easy assembly process, and it has a really good screen. The dual Z-axis lead screws synchronized by a belt to the single Z motor works well. The removable magnetic flex plate makes it easy to remove prints, and so far, I'm pretty proud of myself because I've managed to not destroy this build surface, though it does sometimes hold on to filament a little too well. I also like that it has alignment notches to help you easily get the sheet lined up with the bed. That's the good. Now, here's the bad. Features we are starting to see on low-end printers, such as a filament runout sensor, they're absent from this design, so it can't let you know when you need to run out and get more. For people who like to print modifications to enhance their printers, the plastic base and non-standard aluminum extrusion design significantly reduces the number of mounting points for such things. The printer's SD card only had the Windows version of the Creality Print slicing software, and the Mac version of the Creality Print that I downloaded is kind of a mess. It crashes at random times and the view controls are skittish, and the entire user interface blinks out and comes back when I'm rotating the model on the screen. What about improvements? Well, apart from the lack of a filament runout sensor, the only other thing not on this printer that I would have liked to see is a tool drawer, like on other recent Ender models. There's room for one on the right side of the printer's base, it's just open air inside this area. But of course, that would have increased the complexity of the injection molds and taken additional design time, and therefore increased the cost of the printer. And you know, printing a tool tray to put next to the printer is an easy and useful first project if you're looking for something to print. So, final thoughts? Well, I feel like for the under $200 price, the Ender-3 V3 SE is a steal, and you get a lot for your money. Not every print is perfect, but it does do a pretty good job of printing. It's got a good build volume and a few unexpected features like the bed probe and the strain gauge that you don't normally see on printers in this price category. It doesn't have every bell and whistle imaginable, but it has enough that I think people will be happy with it. So that's the Ender-3 V3 SE. Thanks again to PerGear for sending this over so I could show it to you. Big thanks to everyone who supports the channel, whether with channel memberships or by using the links in the description. If you liked this episode, give it a thumbs up and maybe subscribe so you don't miss new ones. Well, 3D printing friends, that's about all the time we have for this one. And now that we're at the end, Let's go print something cool.